Hey everyone, we're so glad that you're joining with us today. Wherever you're joining us from, we're so glad that you've made our worship service part of your day and that you're finding a moment to worship your God. If you live locally in the Pickerington area, we do want to invite you to our in-person services, 9 a.m. and 11 a.m. We ask that you would call or text the phone number that's on the screen, because we'd ask that you'd make a reservation so that we can ensure you have a seat. If you're not yet ready to return to the building, that's okay. We want you to be as safe as possible. We'll continue to offer these online videos so that you can worship where you're most comfortable right now. If you're not from this local area, please get a hold of us still. We'd love to help you get connected to a good church in your area. Even if they're not meeting yet in person, I'm certain that church will be willing to serve you and get connected with you. So now as we enter into a moment where we're going to worship God together, remember this. We're unified because of His Spirit. We're connected because of His love. And it's the blood of Jesus that makes us one family, whether we're in the same room or not. It is a moment for us right now to be unified as we proclaim His death through communion and we worship the glory of His name through song and prayer and spend some time in the Word. Have a blessed day.
Hallelujah, praise Jehovah, from the heavens praise His name. Praise Jehovah in the highest, all His angels praise proclaim. All His hosts together praise Him, sun and moon and stars on high. Praise Him, all ye end of heaven, and ye floods above the sky. Let them praises give Jehovah, for His name alone is high.
And His glory is exalted.
And His
glory is exalted.
And His
sweet the sound that saved us.
You know, sometimes it's hard to focus on what's important in our lives, and that's because there's so much movement and noise around us often. Sometimes it's hard to remember what's important because there's so much in our minds. Sometimes it's hard to see what is important because there's so much going on in front of our eyes. This time we're in now is affecting so many of us in different ways, and many of those are very challenging and heavy. In spite of all that, I would dare to say that there is opportunity. There's opportunity to focus. There's opportunity to see. And there's opportunity to remember. Remember what is truly important in life. Remember and reflect on those in our lives who are closest to us. A chance to take a breath. In some ways, we can see our lives from a less cluttered way or perspective right now. And we can remember with even more clarity why we are making the eternal choices we're making. Remember the reason that we can live joyfully and confidently today. One of the things you and I may more clearly remember or notice as we are forced to slow down in this time is that there is one rock-solid certainty for all of us, and that is that we have a loving God who is always with us and that He's done some really amazing things for us. So amazing, in fact, it's hard to wrap our minds around them. The list of those incredible things can grow as long as you're willing to put time in that list. But this morning, let's consider just a few things together. Number one, He put eternity into our hearts. The writer of Ecclesiastes says in the third chapter in verse 10, "I have seen the business that God has given to the children of man to be busy with. He's made everything beautiful in its time. Also, He has put eternity into man's heart, yet so that he cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end." The second thing He's done for us is He's made Himself easy to find. Paul would write in Romans in the first chapter in verse 19, he said, "For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For His invisible attributes, namely His eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made, so they are without excuse." There are some of the ways that God reaches out to us to help us find Him. Ultimately, if we continue to pursue God, we'll get closer to Him until we meet His Son, and then we will decide for ourselves just who Jesus is. The third thing I want to offer to you this morning is that God did this incredible thing when He gave His perfect and sinless Son as a sacrifice for every sin that every person has committed and will commit in the time to come. In fact, Paul would write in Philippians 2 and verse 5 these thoughts, "Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though He was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied Himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, He humbled Himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted Him and bestowed on Him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." With those thoughts in mind, let's pray together for the bread. Father, we thank You, God, for the gift of Jesus' life on the cross, for His love and willingness to endure, His body which was broken, beaten, and ultimately killed. Thank You for raising Him from the dead and all that means for us. Be with us now as we think about His body and think about the bread that represents it and what it means to our lives. And in Your Son's name we pray, amen. For the fruit. God, we're often saddened by what Your Son had to endure on our behalf, the treatment that His own creation put upon Him, the spilling of His blood, which happened on our behalf, and we're mindful of that as we partake of this cup. And we're indeed grateful and filled with joy for that and for the cleansing and removal of sin from Your eyes that His blood provides to all who are Christians. We are joyful about His resurrection and His return to glory in heaven. Joy is in our hearts because of the victory over sin, which we all undeservedly receive. Please be with us as we honor Him in this time. Your Son is truly worthy of all praise. May we put Him first in our lives, and let Him be the reason we sing from within our hearts. And it's in His holy and righteous name we pray. Amen.
In need of grace, in need of love, in need of mercy raining down from high above, in need of strength, in need of peace, in need of faith.
2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 7, the Bible says each one must give as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. This passage challenges us to ask ourselves how we really think about giving. Do we give because we think God is a taker? That would be the kind of person who gives reluctantly, under compulsion, seeing giving as a tax that's been imposed upon us? Or do we give because we see and think about God as the very first giver who gives to us? That kind of person is a cheerful giver, one who is excited about it, ready to do it, ready to give because God has been so gracious in giving to us. The opportunity to give financially is not only our moment to participate with God and His work in the world, it is also our opportunity to remember how gracious and giving He's been to us. Let's thank God for how good He has been to us. Our Father, our God in heaven, in this moment we ask You to be heavenly. We ask You to be bigger than anything this world can bring upon us. But we also ask You to be our Father, to be near to us and close to us. We are contemplating now our opportunity to give, and God, I pray that You would grow in each of us a heart that sees You as an abundant giver, one who always provides. And would You help us to be willing to share in that spirit of giving? Father, when we are in need, would You also help us to be recipients? Help us to receive from those who are willing to bless us, knowing it ultimately comes from Your hand. And Father, I pray that You would help us to just take this moment to be ever grateful to how good You've been. In Jesus' name, amen.
Guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but thou art mighty. Hold me with thy powerful hand. Bread of heaven, bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Feed me till I want no more.
Our scripture reading is Nehemiah chapter 2, verses 1 through 8. In the month of Nisan, in the 20th year of King Artaxerxes, when wine was before him, I took up the wine and gave it to the king. Now I had not been sad in his presence, and the king said to me, "Why is your face sad, seeing you are not sick? This is nothing but sadness of the heart." Then I was very much afraid. I said to the king, "Let the king live forever. Why should my face not be sad when the city, the place of my father's graves, lies in ruins, and its gates have been destroyed by fire?" Then the king said to me, "What are you requesting?" So I prayed to the God of heaven, and I said to the king, "If it pleases the king, and if your servant has found favor in your sight, that you send me to Judah, to the city of my father's graves, that I may rebuild it." And the king said to me, the queen sitting beside him, "How long will you be gone, and when will you return?" So it pleased the king to send me when I had given him a time. And I said to the king, "If it pleases the king, let letters be given to me to the governors of the province beyond the river, that they may let me pass through it until I come to Judah, and a letter to Asaph, the keeper of the king's forest, that he may give me timber to make beams for the gates of the fortress of the temple, and for the wall of the city, and for the house that I shall occupy." And the king granted me what I asked, for the good hand of God was upon me. Back in the day when the job of being a blacksmith was a common job, there was a proverb that developed. It went something like this: you got to strike while the iron is hot. And the concept behind that proverb was basically the blacksmith would have to put the material into the fire that he was working with and heat it up to the point where it got hot enough that it could be forged. And when he would pull the material out of the fire and it would be hot, he could bring his hammer down and hit it to the point where it could move and be shaped to the instrument that he was making. But if he waited too long and didn't take action by swinging his hammer while the material was hot, he missed his chance to shape and form the instrument that he was making. Nehemiah chapter 2 is the embodiment of this proverb, striking when the time is right, while the iron is hot. We met Nehemiah last week in chapter 1, where he heard the news that the city of Jerusalem was still in ruins, that the people of Jerusalem were covered in shame by those surrounding them, and it broke his heart. He was weeping, he was fasting, and he was praying over and over to God for revival to come to God's people and to God's city. You know, the need for revival is all around us. It's in our world. We need revival in our nation, in our state, in the cities that we live in our churches. And even when we look in the mirror, we see a person in need, oftentimes, of revival. Now, the key is this. You got to know that when we begin to ask God for this by faith, but we want to see a revival amongst us, He's willing to answer. Nobody wants revival in the world, nation, state. No one wants revival in the churches and in us more than God Himself. And so we began last week in chapter 1 of Nehemiah learning the seeds of true revival. And today we're going to learn the steps of revival. So let's start in verse 1 and learn what the first step is. Now, this first step is a little bit counterintuitive. It doesn't look like progress on the surface, but in fact, it is a crucial step for revival. And that step is waiting. You notice in verse 1, it says it's the month of Nisan. Now, at the beginning of chapter 1, we learn that Nehemiah found out about Jerusalem and God's people in the month of Chislev. Nisan and Chislev are Hebrew months. Now, Chislev was around our December time, and Nisan is around our April time. And so what that tells us right away is that Nehemiah spent about 4 months praying and fasting and being brokenhearted over what was going on. And we're not totally sure why it took so long. Maybe the king wasn't ready to hear from him or didn't have an opportunity with him. Maybe Nehemiah himself just didn't feel prepared or ready. We do know that Nehemiah was praying for 4 months. He was devoting himself to prayer and watching and waiting. Nehemiah here is waiting on the Lord to bring the opportunity. something we're not always so good at doing. We can be pretty hasty with God. We want plans to happen right now. We want revival to take place yesterday. We want things to be different for us in an instant, in a moment. I know when I get pretty hasty with God in seasons of my life, there's a few verses I like to remind myself with, and I'll share them with you. Exodus chapter 14, verse 13, when Moses has led the people of Israel out of Egypt, he brought them to the Red Sea, and the Egyptian army is coming down, breathing down their neck, and they know that they're about to die, and they're scared, and Moses says, "Stand still and see the salvation of your Lord." I love to hear also what Naomi said to Ruth in chapter 3, verse 18, when she was wondering if Boaz was going to be able to redeem her and marry her. Naomi says to Ruth, just let's wait and see what happens. One of my favorites, Psalm 46, verse 10, where we're told to be still and know that I am God. Waiting on God is not wasting your time. It is investing your time in His way. Proverbs chapter 3 is a promise that God has made to us that if we don't just lean on our own understanding, but we trust Him and His guidance, that He will direct our paths and make them straight. He has promised to lead us to where He wants us to go if we will trust Him in all things. Now, if you bump down to verses 2 through 5, you'll see the second step for true revival, and that is courage. Nehemiah comes to the king, and the king notices that Nehemiah is sad, and he wants to know why he's sad. Now, this is a pretty risky situation for Nehemiah. The only way that a king in those days really got removed from power was to be assassinated. The most common way that they would do this would be through the cupbearer, who would bring poisonous wine to the king. And any time that the king lost any trust or faith in his cupbearer, any time that he wondered about him, he simply would just have him executed. But the king asks him, "Hey, Nehemiah, what's going on? What's wrong with you?" And he seems to be genuinely inquiring, like Nehemiah and he have developed some sort of rapport, and he trusts Nehemiah and thinks he has integrity. And here's the moment where Nehemiah's been waiting for. The king is actually asked, "What's on your mind?" And I love what it says in verse 2. "I was greatly afraid." I don't know about you, but I kind of get it why Nehemiah was afraid. Not just for the loss of his life, but for the moment finally showing up. The opportunity is here, and he feels afraid. It's pretty normal, isn't it? You know, we think about our lives changing. We think about things being different. We wanting things to be better. That involves change, and change is scary for us. As humans who like habit and routine, as creatures of things that become familiar to us, seeing things being different or wanting something so bad, and then the moment comes where you get to ask for it, but you're afraid that you might not get it, can stir up all kinds of fears that we have in us. But here's what Nehemiah does to get his courage to be able to ask the king for what he needs. The first thing he does to get courage is that he prays. Look down in verse 4, you'll see that when the king says, "Okay, what do you want me to do?" When Nehemiah tells him, "Of course my heart's sad. The city of my father's graves lies in ruin." And the king goes, "What do you want?" Here's the moment, the instant. Nehemiah has been praying for 4 months for this opportunity to ask him to do something. And here it is. And the first thing he does is he prays. Now, I don't think he fell on his knees and said, "Dear God, I want to thank you for this day and the many blessings we've received." I don't think that he audibly spoke a prayer. I think it was in his heart and his mind. It was probably something like, "Give me the words, Lord. Be present with me, Lord." And in an instant, he prayed and then he spoke. You see, Nehemiah had a great rhythm of prayer. He had blocks of prayer, time of prayer that he was praying continuously, long time in prayer. And then when the moment was there, he didn't abandon prayer, but prayer became the thing that linked him up to what God wanted him to do. Prayer is the pathway into understanding the plans that God has for us. The second thing that Nehemiah did for courage was that he had vision. Look in verse 5 how he answers the king after he prays. It says in verse 5, "And I said to the king, if it pleases the king, And if your servant has found favor in your sight, that you may send me to Judah, to the city of my father's graves, that I may rebuild it. He speaks to the king about what he wants to do. He has hope. He has vision. He has a goal and a dream. You see, he doesn't just tell the king what's wrong. Hey, my family's city is torn up and blown up. He doesn't just say to the king, hey, I don't like that there's destruction and back in Jerusalem. Isn't it terrible? When the king says, what do you want me to do? He says, send me back because I want to rebuild it. Now, it's good for us. It's important for us to be able to identify what's wrong, whether it's in our life, in our church, in our city, our state, our world. It's good for us to do that. You've got to start there because you can't fix something unless you know what's broken. But at some point, if you don't develop an idea, a vision, a hope of how things are supposed to be, of what you long to see happen, you will eventually lose heart. You and I grow weary of just being obsessed with everything that's wrong. And change doesn't happen just because we focus on what's wrong. Change happens when we see what could be done well or right. For example, in your own life, your life won't change just because you obsess over your sins. I run into this oftentimes in ministry where people want to change, but the only thing they think about, the only thing they have their minds wrapped around is all of their sins, all of their shortcomings, all the things that they don't like about themselves. You see, we don't stop sinning because we obsess with sin. We stop sinning when we obsess with Jesus. When you get a vision of what you could be, it magnetizes you to where God wants to take you. So Nehemiah found courage through prayer and through a vision of what could be. That leads us to the third step of revival. When you go down to verses 6 and 8, we learn that the third step in true revival is planning. This is what Nehemiah must have been doing with his time for 4 months, praying, but also researching and planning and developing an idea of how this could be done. It's obvious because he has all the answers he needs for all the king's questions. Now you see, it's not enough for us just to beg God for things to be different and not willing to put in time or energy to put plans together for how that can be done. Prayer is not a replacement for planning. Prayer is the pathway for us to understand what our plans should be. And here's what Nehemiah's planning involved. The first thing is timing. The king asks him, how long do you think you'll be gone? How long will this take? Obviously, Nehemiah had spent some time thinking, okay, we've got to travel, and I know roughly the dimensions probably of the city. I don't know the total condition of the wall, but let's say you got to totally rebuild it. You know, he's just thinking about this. And he puts a plan together for how long it will be. In fact, he spends almost 12 years in Jerusalem. And he shares that with the king. He's realistic with the king. And you and I, when it comes to timing, with regards to real revival in our lives and our churches and our world, have to be realistic with this as well. We want it to happen overnight. We want it to happen in an instant. And the reality is, if we want to see our lives change, our churches grow, if we want to see our world become better, we've got to be realistic about the time it takes for plans to come into place and to happen. The second thing that Nehemiah is prepared for is the access he will need, the authority, the security. He knows that he's going to have to travel from Susa to Jerusalem. He's going to have to go through some hostile places. And he asks for the king to give him authority from the king to be able to travel through those places safely so that he can arrive in Jerusalem. Change in our life, wherever it may be, revival in our lives or in our churches, our world, is going to make us go through some places that are going to be difficult. And we're going to have to ask God for assistance, for help to navigate those places that could be dangerous for us so that we can ultimately arrive at the destination that he has for us. You see, when you and I are really working towards true revival in the Word of God, in our lives, in our churches, where we live, it means that we're going to actually have to move to some places that get difficult. There are going to be all kinds of challenges that arise for our lives to really change. And we need to ask the true king for his authority and strength to go to the places that we need to go to see revival happen. Now, the last thing Nehemiah asks for is resources. He knows he's going to need some stuff to get this work done. So he asks the king for permission to be granted that he gets timber from his forest, the king's forest. And he's asking for his help because he's asking for him to actually even pay for it. And he knows the items that he's going to need to get this done. This is his shopping list. This is his strategy, his plan. And so Nehemiah has put together a comprehensive plan to get from being the cupbearer in Susa to a wall built in Jerusalem. He knows what it's going to take. And so you and I, if we're really going to have true revival in our lives, we're going to have to actually pray, wait on the Lord, have the courage to strike when the iron is hot. But when that moment comes, we need to be people who are prepared to know what it's going to take to see those changes really happen. We can't just sit back and go, hey, God, can you make things different but not participate? We can't just sit back and go, hey, God, will you fix so-and-so or this the problem over here and just expect God with a zap to do that. He wants our participation with him in revival. And so that means that you and I also must be willing to make plans for this to happen. Now, you notice the last sentence in verse 8. The king grants him everything he needs. But then he says it was the hand of the Lord on him. You see, Nehemiah knows where all the good blessings of life come from. When all this comes together and he's in the instant, in the moment, it's happening, Nehemiah doesn't go, oh man, what a great strategist I am. The king just bought my plan. He must think I'm really smart and trust me, I must be great. He doesn't think that. He also doesn't think, oh man, this king I have is the greatest king ever, and because he's so nice, he's going to do this for me. He doesn't think that. He goes, it's the hand of God that's on me. So because the king grants him all that he's asked for, he's able to do what he needs to do to save God's people and to save God's city. And what's so beautiful about this is many years later, a greater than Nehemiah would show up on the scene. Someone who would be a savior for all people, who would show up to build a city for God that's not tied to this human world here that we live in, a city of God, a city on a hill, not some location, but the church, the people of God. One who would be like Nehemiah, but he saved us not because he got everything he asked for from the king, but quite the opposite. He didn't get what he asked for from the king. You see, when Jesus himself was in the garden, he said, if there is any other way, Father, let's do it that way, not this way. And he didn't get what he asked from the king. And then when he's hanging on the cross, he cries out to God again, appealing to the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. He says, God, my God, why have you forsaken me? And then deafening silence and no answer. And because that Savior didn't get what he asked for from the king, you and I could be saved. He took exactly what sin deserved from God in his wrath justly. He absorbed it all so that you and I wouldn't have to absorb that. Now, you and I can look to our Savior, our greater than Nehemiah, our Jesus, and go, I want your life, I want your death, your burial, and your resurrection to be the thing that saves me before God. And so when I stand before God and he says, who do you trust in? Who do you rely upon? I want to say, I trust Jesus. I die to myself. God, don't evaluate me based upon my life because I'll fail. Evaluate me based upon Jesus, and I know with certainty that I'll be able to dwell with you in heaven. And the way that we unite ourselves to Jesus' life, death, burial, and resurrection is through faith to trust what he's done and the act of baptism where we are washed of our sins, the old self dies, and he says when we're raised back to life, we are a new creation. That's where revival begins, with a step of faith that says, I trust you and not myself. If you need help learning to become a Christian, if it's your time, you need to strike while the iron is hot of faith, to become one with Jesus by saying, I trust you and I want to die to myself in baptism and be raised to the newness of life, where your life can start clean and you can walk with God. So if there's anything we can do to help you in this moment right now, please just contact us. We want to help you know who Jesus is, come to follow him, and experience the revival of your soul that happens as your sins are washed away and you're raised to walk in a new life.
Good morning. On behalf of the Pickerington Church Christ, I'd like to thank you for joining us for services this morning. If there's any way at all that we can serve you, please don't hesitate to contact us and let us know how we can best make that happen. Let's end with a prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this wonderful time that we can live in with the technological advances that we have, that we can still come together to worship you, not physically, but still together in spirit. And we thank you for this opportunity. We pray that everything that we did this morning was pleasing to your ears. It's in your Son's name that we pray. Amen.